But fear no more. I would not take this thing. If it lay by the highway, not were Minas Tirith falling in ruin, and I alone could save her. So, using the weapon of the Dark Lord for her good and my glory. No, I do not wish for such triumphs, Frodo, son of Drogo. Neither did the council, said Frodo, nor do I. I would have nothing to do with such matters. For myself, said Faramir, I would see the white tree in flower again, in the courts of the kings, and the silver crown return, and Minas Tirith in peace, Minas Anor again as of old, full of light, high and fair, beautiful as a queen among other queens, not a mistress of many slaves, nay, not even a kind mistress of willing slaves. War must be, while we defend our lives against a destroyer who would devour all. But I do not love the bright sword for its sharpness, nor the arrow for its swiftness, nor the warrior for his glory. I love only that which they defend, the city of the men of Numenor, and I would have her loved for her memory, her ancientry, her beauty, and her present wisdom, not feared, save as men may fear the dignity of a man, old and wise. Greetings and well met, my friends. Yoistin here, and I hope you all are doing well, wherever you are in Middle-earth. Today we will be talking about a great man and hero of the Third Age, and one whose messages and wisdom must not be forgotten. Faramir, the captain of Gondor and a man of high quality. I will link some related articles and videos in the description and cards for more information, so please check those out. My friends, thank you all so much for joining me today. Let's begin our tale. Faramir was born in 2983 of the Third Age, making him 36 years old during the main events of the War of the Ring in 3019. He was the youngest son of the Gondorian steward Denethor II and Finduilis of Dol Amroth, whose brother was Prince Imrahil. Faramir's older brother was Boromir, the High Warden of the White Tower, and Boromir was 5 years older than Faramir. Faramir would only be 5 when his mother passed, and he was not the favorite son of his father, but Faramir and Boromir always had a close bond of brotherly love, akin to Isildur and Anarion of old. While Boromir would be a fighter who loved battle and glory, Faramir would indeed be a good soldier and captain, having trained in the sword and bow, but he did not love battle or war, only that which those things defended. Like his father, the blood of Numenor, of Western Ess, ran nearly true in Faramir, but it was not so apparent in Boromir. Even with their differences, Boromir and Faramir would be best friends, and there would be no great conflict between them. As Faramir grew up, he developed a love for lore, music, and culture. He would also be fond of the wizard Gandalf, who came to the city from time to time, and Faramir would glean wisdom from the Maia, even though his father disapproved. And so Faramir would come of age, and in the year 3018, during the first battle of the War of the Ring, Sauron would send his forces into Osgiliath, and Boromir and Faramir commanded the forces of Gondor. The two brothers held the line on the last bridge across the Anduin until it was destroyed, and only the two of them, as well as two others, would survive the encounter by swimming. Now, before Boromir set out on his quest, Faramir had a prophetic dream concerning a broken sword, Isildur's bane, and halflings. Boromir would have this dream once as well, but Faramir had it multiple times. However, Lord Denethor, much to his later regret, would send Boromir to Rivendell to investigate the dream, while Faramir stayed in Gondor as a captain, and would eventually go into Ithilien to command the rangers therein. But on the 26th of February in the year 3019, Faramir and his father heard in Gondor the faraway sounds of the Horn of Gondor that were sounded near Parth Galen, ere Boromir fell in battle. One night, Faramir, either in a vision or in truth, would see an elvish boat come down the Anduin with Boromir's body upon it. It would continue off, going to sea. Now, it is important to note that Faramir's character, with this vision, as well as his prophetic dreams and Numenorean heritage, is thematically and in character one who has a distinct relationship with fate, foresight, and dooms, especially for a man. So one might believe that only in his mind's eye, and in a vision, he saw Boromir in such a state, or perhaps he did in truth. Either way, the shards of the Horn of Gondor would indeed be recovered from the river by the rangers of Ithilien, and they would go to Denethor. Anyway, some few days later, while harassing Haradrim and their Mumakil on the road that ran through Ithilien, Faramir and his rangers detected two hobbits and detained them, ere the skirmish with the Haradrim began. Faramir and his folk were distrustful of these hobbits at first, As Frodo and Sam claimed to be mere travelers, and Faramir believed there were only servants of the White Tower or the Dark Tower in that land. Even so, they continued to speak, and it became known that the hobbits had been friends and companions of Boromir. Faramir spoke to them of his brother's death, and they knew not about it until that moment. They spoke also of Aragorn, Isildur's heir who took up the now reforged sword of Elendil, and they confirmed that they were the hobbits of which Faramir's dreams spoke. Gollum was one thing that the hobbits lied about, trying to act as if they were alone. Faramir and his rangers brought Frodo and Sam to Henoth Annwn, a secret base of rangers not far from their position, as he was still somewhat unsure of them and the road was not safe. However, on the way to the outpost, before the hobbits were blindfolded, Faramir showed his true nature, for he spoke some of his philosophies to them, saying that he would not take Frodo's burden, Isildur's bane, whatever it was. In Henoth Annwn, the hobbits rested and were given dinner, and they observed the rituals and customs of the Dúnedain of the south, as they looked west from the window on the west, towards the island of men that was, and the elven home that still is, before they took dinner. After dinner, more conversation was had, where they deepened their dialogue from before, and spoke of topics such as Gandalf, the lore of Numenor, and of Lothlórien. But during the conversation, Sam made the mistake of mentioning the One Ring, for before they had kept that and other things about their errand hidden during the conversation. Faramir then knew that Isildur's bane was the One Ring, and that he could take it if he truly wanted to. But for Faramir, the trial was far clearer than it had been for Boromir, and he laughed and held to his former words, that he would not take this thing. And I imagine that he would have made the same decision, even if he had not said before that he would not take that thing. He knew of the flaws of Boromir, and that this must have been too difficult a trial for his late older brother. Ere they departed that conversation for the night, Sam said that Faramir showed that his quality was the highest. Sam said that Faramir reminded him of Gandalf, and Faramir claimed that it was rather the heir of Numenor he sensed. Sam and Frodo slept some that night, but Faramir awoke Frodo and Sam, and took them to look upon a creature in the water below Henoth Annwn. Gollum had followed them, and fished then in the Forbidden Pool, and the penalty for such an act was death. But Faramir had a merciful heart, and let Frodo go down to him to convince Gollum to follow him. Once the creature was captured, Faramir treated him very kindly for a prisoner, and he had words with him about their road and so forth. At the end of their conversation, he would lay a doom upon Sméagol, that death should find him quickly if he betrayed the hobbits. Faramir also offered Frodo and Sam protection in Gondor that would last a year and a day, unless they went forth to the steward before then. He only asked that they did not reveal Henoth Annwn to any. The next morning, Faramir gave what advice, rations, and supplies to the hobbits as he could, and while he would have let the hobbits find their way without blindfolds from the secret outpost, as he now trusted them, he would have blindfolded Gollum. But Frodo objected, and had all three of them blindfolded, so Gollum was less afraid. When they had gone far enough, Faramir and the hobbits had some departing words. For the hobbits, Faramir had been their friend unlooked for on the road that Elrond foretold them of. For this, they were glad. The hobbits and Gollum would continue to go to the pass of Cirith Ungol, and Faramir would lead his rangers to Osgiliath to stay the defenses there. But he soon had to retreat from Osgiliath to Minas Tirith, almost being caught by the Nazgûl and their fell beasts. But luckily for him and his allies, Faramir's mentor of old had returned from death, the death Frodo had told him about, and the white rider Gandalf came forth from the city and saved Faramir from the Nazgûl. When Pippin saw him, Faramir seemed to him lordly, somewhat like Aragorn but almost as a king born into later days, whose heir was not as high as Aragorn's. Faramir was also amazed to see another halfling, and one in the livery of the White Tower. Faramir then reported of the outer defenses and Frodo and Sam to Denethor, with Gandalf and Pippin there also. It was during that conversation when Denethor reaffirmed his feelings about Faramir, knowing that he had made a mistake of sending Boromir to Rivendell instead of Faramir. This conversation also showed how involved Gandalf had been, for according to Denethor, Boromir had been more resistant to Gandalf than Faramir was, and Denethor disliked how his second son was a wizard's pupil. Before long, and after a war council the next day, Faramir was forced to depart the city once again, to return to the rangers who remained at Osgiliath. Gandalf bade Faramir to not throw his life away, for he would be needed at the city, in things other than war. Gandalf said that Denethor loved Faramir and would remember it before the end, for Faramir wanted his father to think of him differently, if he would return. And so, during this ill-wrought venture, Faramir would hold only for a little while, but the host of the Witch King that marched towards the Pelennor was too great. Gandalf had ridden out later to check on Faramir and his men, but things were grim. Gandalf and some others came back to Minas Tirith, and Faramir led his rearguard company back to the White City. But he was overcome by the black breath of the Nazgul, and a poisoned dart from a champion of Harad. Prince Imrahil and his riders from Dol Amroth went forth and saved the prince's nephew from the onslaught. Imrahil brought his nephew to Denethor, who during the Battle of the Pelennor Fields sought to burn himself and his son alive, who he deemed already dead. Only after Faramir had returned in this state did Denethor truly break, and his despair ended any semblance of leadership on his behalf. So after a time of Faramir's incapacitation, Denethor sent for his servants to prepare a pyre that would burn the final stewards of the House of Anarion. But it was not to be so. By the aid of Pippin, Gandalf, and Beregond, a man who fought for and loved Faramir as his captain, Faramir was not burned, and he was saved. In this, Beregond did play an important role, for if Denethor could not burn his son, he tried to kill him with a knife, and Beregond stood in between them, so Faramir would not be killed. Even though Denethor perished, Faramir was brought to the Houses of Healing, and soon after the battle, Aragorn would sneak into the city and heal him, alongside Eowyn of Rohan and Merry the Halfling, who themselves had seen battle. Faramir would not go with the Host of the West to the Battle of the Black Gate. Rather, he would heal with and find love in Eowyn. His hope for new days and renewal would help Eowyn break her own sorrow. And when the One Ring was destroyed and Sauron met his fate, Faramir was reminded of the fall of Numenor. But it was the end of he who saw the destruction of Numenor. I have a video on the love story between Faramir and Eowyn for more information. And so when the Host of the West returned victorious to Minas Tirith, Faramir, the then ruling steward of Gondor, led the ceremony of coronation for Aragorn Elessar. By the rule of Elessar, Faramir and his line would be reinstated as stewards in the same way as they operated before the failing of the kings of Gondor, many centuries before. Furthermore, Faramir would be the Prince of Ithilien, set with guarding the eastern borders of Gondor and cleansing the Morgul Vale. And both were places he knew well. Aragorn, who had slain men of Gondor to save his captain from the pyre, would be allowed to go with Faramir, but he could not return to the White City. He would be the head of Faramir's guard, the White Company. At Edoras, Faramir and Eowyn would be married, and the two of them would settle in Emyn Arnon, a range of hills in Ithilien that was in sight of Minas Tirith. They would have at least one son named Elberon, who inherited his father's duties as Prince of Ithilien and Steward when Faramir died in 82 of the Fourth Age, at the age of 120. He lived a long life due to the immense amount of Numenorean blood within him. One of their descendants, likely their grandson, would be named Barahir, and he wrote the tale of Aragorn and Arwen, and likely further carried on the duties and line of Faramir. And so, it is in the hills of Emyn Arnon, during a time of peace and love for what was restored and renewed, where we find the end of our tale about Faramir, the captain of Gondor. From the tale of Faramir, we see many wise things, and I think it is important to remember what he stood for. Wisdom, mercy, peace, lore, music, and love, rather than war, battle, and vain glory. If we must fight, these are the things we should fight for. Thank you all so much for watching. I hope you all enjoyed today's video. If you did, please be sure to hit that like button and share this with a friend. What are your thoughts, questions, additions, and corrections about Faramir? Let me know in the comments below. For me, Faramir is such a great character, and one I love reading about in the books. I can see why Tolkien himself most identified with Faramir out of any character in The Lord of the Rings, and I think we can all strive to be more like him. Please check out our music channel, Facebook, Twitter, merch, and Patreon for our Discord server and podcasts. Links are in the description below. I also wanted to give a shout out and thanks to our Valor Tier patrons over on Patreon. Adrian De La Tour, Chris Ortner, Peter Shepard, Kyle Wetzel, Lane Grimes, Samuel McBee, Jonathan Putnam, and Kyrie Kawaii. Thank you all so much. Finally, don't forget to subscribe and hit that bell button to join the Men of the West and all of the Free Peoples today, and I'll see you all again next week with a video on how the One Ring, Arkenstone, and Silmarils all play a similar role. Everyone, as always, thank you all so much for joining me on this adventure. Until the next one, my great friends.